Hello everyone and welcome back. This is Ibrahim Quraishi here and we are continuing our VMware tutorial for beginners session 25th. In today's session, we are going to introduce some new topics. What I'm going to deep dive in is this agenda here a little bit before we start the session. So we have covered data stores, we have covered VMFS file systems, and then we dived into networking. So for those of you who are following me, you can remember we have done standard switches, distributed switches, and the previous session which we completed, which was session 24, which was around different types of traffic which we managed. Now, today is a new topic completely. We are going to deep dive into VMware technologies, which are really specific to VMware, which gives you the agility, the flexibility of having an automated and a dynamic environment, and that is achieved by having these features enabled by VMware. So we are going to look into basically the migrations which we have done in the past as well, but we are going to deep dive into vMotion, how we can achieve it, what are the prerequisite, and different types of vMotion. Like obviously we have compute vMotion, we have storage vMotion, so we'll eventually go and do a live demo for vMotion. Then going forward, we'll be doing cluster configurations, so don't miss out. We'll be looking into the very famous HA, which is high availability. Then we'll be looking at how VMware distributes the load, the workload of compute across storage and also across the ESX host by using distributed resource scheduler DRS. And we are going to look a little bit around what are the features for having, what are the requirement for having EVC mode, and why would you want to enable it. As always, don't forget to leave your feedback, and don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification buttons. So as discussed, agenda for today is vMotion prerequisites, and then we'll be doing deep dive into compute vMotion and storage vMotions. So vMotion prerequisite is, first of all, you need to have identical server, CPU or MIC. So sometimes you can find different manufacturer use the same CPU, so that can work as well. So but the requirement is the CPU should be the same, same instruction set, same CPU model. But you can't switch from Intel to AMD. That's a completely different manufacturer, and then the instruction set will change completely. But you can have a HP Intel with a specific number of CPU, and maybe you can find a similar one in Dell, and you can mix and match. But as long as the CPU instructions matches, then you will be able to do vMotion with it. We'll look into this a little bit deeper when we are doing vMotions. But the other requirement again is vMotion network needs to be configured. Again, I have shown you guys how to enable vMotion using standard switches. You can also do the same using distributed switches. Then the next topic to make sure vMotion works is, obviously, you need to have shared storage. So we have also talked about a little bit around shared storage, how I have provisioned my storage over here in my lab using FreeNAS, and I have used iSCSI protocol for that. And there's a session which I have done around it. If you want to look into that, you can see that how I have achieved shared storage. But obviously in general, for virtualization, networking is shared, storage is shared to be able to move things around. And we'll look into a demo and I'll give you some examples going forward. The other topics which we will leverage obviously with vMotion is high availability and DRS, which we'll be covering in the next sessions. Cluster of ESX hosts. So yeah, another requirement is, obviously, if you want to do vMotion, you need to have that host at least in the same cluster. Now, with the 6.7, we can do cross-cluster vMotions, but specifically for this particular session, we are going to assume that we are doing vMotions within a cluster. Okay, so I'm just cautious of the time now. So compute vMotion. vMotion is moving a VM from one host to another host. We can do a live migration and we can also do a cold migration. Cold migration is when the virtual machine is powered off. Live migration, again, as it says, when it is powered on and it's running. So what happens under the hood? The CPU and memory content is copied from one host to another one. So that's how vMotion happens. So let's have a quick look. Have a very expensive drawing utility here, which is Microsoft Paint. So you can see here that we have a host ESX01 and ESX02, and then we can do a vMotion. We have certain requirements, we have certain requirements for vMotion, of course, and as long as those requirements are met, I can move this particular machine to here. Didn't want to chop it off, but yeah, to this machine. And that is done by enabling vMotion network, making sure the CPU set or the CPUs which we are using, the model of the hardware we are using is the same one, and of course having shared storage, and then obviously the servers which we are using is actually provisioned in the storage, and they are connected or they are provisioned from here. So all these servers basically are sitting here in storage and connected to the host. So obviously this is your A, B and C servers, and they are basically in the storage and they are connected here. Hope that gives you an idea. So this shared storage is important, the network is important, the vMotion network, and having the same set of or having the same model of the hardware for the server is important. So you can stick to AMD. If you're buying an AMD, you have to stick to AMD. If you're buying Intel, then you have to stick to Intel. And then last and not the least, you need to make sure this is within a cluster to be able to leverage other features like HA, DRS and everything else. Okay, let's get back to our slides now. I'm cautious, it's 9 minutes done already. So vMotion network can be enabled on management traffic, or we can have a dedicated vSwitch for the traffic. So I did mention this before, guys. So we could potentially have a isolated vMotion network, which is what I would suggest, because I wouldn't want you to use or leverage management traffic, because vMotion traffic can be a little bit heavier when compared, like when you are doing a production environment, you need to always consider to have it on an isolated subnet and a VLAN, really, on its own physical, isolated physical NIC. So what happens is you are not actually overwhelming or overloading your management traffic. Management traffic is for your host to connect to the vCenter and for you to manage it. And that's all it is for. But obviously, if you don't have any options, then VMware does give you this flexibility of using the management network. So we'll have a quick look here what I mean by that. So as we discussed in one of the sessions before, you have virtual switches, and in the switches you have got different types of switches, right? So over here, if you go to adapters, you'll find a switch which is management switch. And then if we edit that, you will find a checkbox which you can enable to allow vMotion. So this is what I'm talking about. So this is leveraging the management network for vMotion. But normally you wouldn't have this on. You would have a switch, virtual switch dedicated for vMotion traffic. But in my lab, I have used it like this. Okay, let's quickly complete this slides and then jump in the live session again. Hang on, the slides are back here. So as discussed, can be vMotion can be enabled, or vMotion traffic can be enabled from management traffic, or we can have dedicated, as always, have a dedicated vSwitch for the traffic or a distributed switch. It's up to you, but I would recommend it to be a standard switch, really. Storage vMotion. vMotion happening on storage level. Excuse me. So vMotion happening on... let's start again. So storage vMotion, moving VMs from one data store to another data store is called storage vMotion. So we might have more than one data store and one is getting overwhelmed by VMs. So you have storage vMotion enabled, and then you can manually move VMs to other data stores, or you can have it on fully automated DRS, and then basically DRS take care of it. As soon as you are hitting a 20% threshold, it moves the VM to a different data store which is less busier. It can be all, as well that that one of the data store is not full but it's very busy with IOs. Basically VMware may decide to move it to a different move some VMs to a different data store. Okay then, so let's dive into a demo. So you have seen this bit which I was telling you about management traffic. I also told you the shared storage which we have, and I'm using iSCSI traffic, iSCSI network for that. So you can see the VM nick one which I have created for iSCSI, but again it's going through the same virtual switch which I have. Okay, so this is my demo cluster. As you have been seeing since a long time now, I've been using this cluster now. And if you look at the host, I have two hosts, one ending with 103, 104. Okay, so we can see here on 103, we have three virtual machines, and on 104, we have two virtual machines. If you look at the summary, we can see potentially how much CPU and memory has been used. So this is a host with 6 gig memory. CPU is hardly used here. And then this is a host with 6 gig again, and CPU is hardly used. So let's move maybe the CentOS machine to a different host. So you select, right click, and select migrate. You'll have two options: compute, change compute resource only, and then you have another option to change storage only. And there is in the new 6.7 you'll find another option: change both compute resource and storage. So this is for migrating to a storage which doesn't have, which does not have shared storage. This is what I was talking about. Normally with your, when you're doing within a cluster, you'll only use this or this, because obviously you will have shared storage available anyway. And then when you are doing change both compute and resource, migrate the virtual machine to a specific host or cluster and their storage to be a specific data store or a data store cluster. So then you need to select a resource first. So either you will select a compute, or then once you have done compute, then you'll select a storage, right? So for now we are going to do compute vMotion. To make it more interesting, I'm going to run a command here, open a command prompt and run a ping 192.168.1.130 is the IP for this machine. 130-T, as you can see, ping command has started. I'm going to migrate it now. So we are going to move it to 4. So validation is completed. So this is the point when you'll find out if there is any issues. So it's going to go to the same network, and then this is all you have to do, and click finish. So you are seeing the migration happening now. It's 56%, 72%, and then you see the ping drop there, and then the VM has been moved here. And then over here you only have two machines. Let's try it again. Let's move it back, right click, migrate. So VMware basically has a lot of pride to say that when you do a live migration like this from one host to other, you only have a one ping drop, which is what I'm showing you here, a single ping drop, request timeout only once. And again, it is by making sure VMware suggests that you have to have a minimum of 1 gig connection for doing these sort of activities, bare minimum, or more the better. Obviously, you can, if you have a 10 gig connection, that even better. So I'm going to put it back on 103 again. So select that, click finish. In 103, it's only two machines. The migration is 56%, 70-90%. There you go. You can see the machine appear here. And it was so quick, there wasn't any ping drop either. Can you see that? Brilliant, isn't it? So there is another thing which I want to show you. Before that, obviously, I want to show you how much this VM is using the storage. Let's minimize this for now. Expand this. Storage vMotion. So this VM is using 2 gig. So if I right click and migrate, so I can migrate the storage to a different storage. So potentially I can move, hang on, I need to select storage this time, sorry, because I'm doing storage vMotion, and then click next. So I'm going to move it to the local disk of this server, which is local here because I don't have another shared LAN. But that's how it happens. So it's basically migrating. That's it, boom, 100% relocated. So now this server is running on the local disk of this server, so it's no longer on the shared storage. If I click on data stores, you can see this one, this data store, and the VM running here is this particular Kali Linux. So that's how quick, because it's only 2 gig, this is why I used it. Use space is only 2 gig and it's so it's internal anyway. So that's why it was so quick. So let's move it back, migrate, and move it back, change storage. Yeah, and then where are we moving it? It's to the shared resources, shared LAN, and then finish. It's going to be disappearing from here soon. Yeah, it's gone, and it will be here. There you go. So that's about it, guys. I hope you enjoyed the session today. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to reach out to me on my blog, Ibrahim Quraishi. On my Twitter, Ibrahim Quraishi, and check out my blog, Agile Ops, as well, agileops.co.uk. Don't forget that. Question of the day, I forgot to put it in. Or maybe I did. Name the different types of traffic. So this is from the old session. Question of the day today is, what are the requirements for having a vMotion? Name a couple of them, and that will be it, really. So I'll be waiting for your comments. Don't forget to subscribe, and enjoy watching and keep sharing, guys. Cheers, bye.